Yes, good afternoon, Dr. Manjunatha. I'm Dr. Kathiani and all students. I'm extremely happy for this special lecture on urban planning and sustainability. You know, we used to conduct lectures like this from industry persons on whenever we teach any subject. So this way, it is very useful to the students, so they also understand what is in the field, than apart from what is there in the books. So I'm happy to welcome him, Dr. Manjunatha, and we can start. Yes, sir, you can proceed.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, AIT, for this wonderful opportunity. My dear students and faculty members.
1 second, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, now
oh, it's sorry, sorry. Yeah.
Okay. So talking about urban planning and sustainability, we all know like how the things are shaping. My presentation will be in four stages. One, I will be talking about our company, JSW Group, how we are managing sustainability and development as a group company.
Sorry for the interruption. Sorry.
Yeah.
Sir, 1 second, sir. We have to introduce yourself, sir. 1 minute. The girl is
waiting. Okay. Okay. Okay.
Please proceed, Dr. Kathiani. Yes.
Oh, I'll proceed to that, sir.
Teertha, yes.
Yes, sir.
A warm welcome to one and all. I'm Teertha Daljit. Today, I'm extremely honored to introduce before you a true scholar who has 27 years of experience in total in fields of construction, building materials, techno-marketing, application development, branding, mentoring, and advising in the construction industry, corporate and industries, service sectors, startups, new product development, business development, sales and product training, etc. A true inspiration for blooming engineers who are more into research-based learnings, he has 12 years of research experience and over 27 research papers in national and international journals and in 40 conferences. He traveled to Singapore to present his research paper at Structural Engineers World Congress, SEWC 2015. He also attended SEWC 2019 World Conference as a chairman of Indian delegation representing ACCI. Breaking the curiosity, I would like to share his academic profile. He holds BE in Civil Engineering from UVCE Bangalore University, MBA from International Institute of Advanced Marketing, Mumbai, PGDFM from IGNOU, PGDM from the Alliance University, PG program in Concrete Technology from CGLI, the United Kingdom, Future Fit program from ISB Hyderabad, PhD in Management from Haridwar University. He was a life member of ICI, Instruct, IOV, ISTD, ACCI, and American Concrete Institute, the Indian chapter. At present, he is the Associate Vice President, Direct Sales of JSW Cement Limited, Bangalore. We're extremely glad to meet someone who is constantly pursuing his research interests in various areas such as green building materials, concrete admixtures, special concrete, alternatives to river sand, new construction technology, and new product developments, and training on skills development for civil engineers and advisor on career development for young engineers and management students. He has delivered more than 300 guest and expert lectures across the countries, visiting many engineering and management colleges for training young students on new skills. We are thankful to our dear Kathiani ma'am and Mr. Muthumani sir for coordinating such an opportunity. And let me invite Dr. L.R. Manjunatha. Welcome to our institute, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Tirtha. Thank you, Dr. Kathiani and Muthumani sir for this wonderful opportunity. I think VIT and our Vasugi madam, I had come and done a physical program at Chennai. Two times I have done, actually. In fact, my association with VIT is very strong. So I keep visiting Chennai, and some two, three programs I've really delivered lectures. Today's topic is urban planning and sustainability. My presentation will be on four phase. One will be on company, JSW. Second will be on why planning is very important. Urban planning is very important. The third will be on smart cities, how the smart cities are shaping in India and globally. how they are planning smart cities. Okay, we may be seeing so many smart cities have been announced: Coimbatore, Madurai, Bangalore, Chennai. How we are doing smart cities, and how globally smart cities are getting developed. After that, I'm going towards materials, because which is my core subject. How materials can make the construction and smart cities more sustainable and durable. So this is my four stages of presentation, and I'll be summarizing with the inputs to all of you that how being young engineers, you can take it forward, the urban planning properly and also on sustainability parameters. So JSW Group, one of the largest conglomerate in India, and we are largest integrated building materials company. We build this nation. We are one of the largest steel producing company in the world. And we are close to about 22 million ton capacity currently. Going forward, we are going to be about 60 million ton capacity. Then we have energy. JSW very much into energy. Earlier we were in thermal energy and also hydel energy. Recently we have ventured into wind and solar energy. And we are establishing plants down south Tamil Nadu, Tirunelveli, in that area, close to 400 megawatt of energy. 2000 crores investment from JSW Energy is happening in Tamil Nadu. And also we are putting a factory in Salem. We have a steel factory in Salem, and we are putting one more GGBS factory in Salem. And by this March 2022, this plant will be operational. So investment in Tamil Nadu from JSW Group is very high. And we have cement manufacturing facility with a total capacity of 14 million tons, which is going to be 25 million tons in next 3 to 4 years time. So we are one of the fastest growing cement company in India. Recently, 2 years ago, we ventured into paints also. We manufacture India's eco-friendly paints. Why I'm giving all these inputs is that JSW as a group, we have embedded with the technology and sustainability. And we are the most energy efficient cement producing company in the world in terms of reduction in the carbon footprint. So globally, we are producing about 4.1 billion tons of cement. And each and every ton of cement produced liberates about 650 average kgs of carbon dioxide. Taking that into average, cement industry itself liberates about 2.1 gigatons of carbon dioxide. That's called greenhouse gas emissions. And India is the second largest producer of cement in the world. So looking at our investment, close to $800 billion US dollars investment is coming in next 2 years time for infrastructure development. So cement is one of the main component along with steel in infrastructure development. So how we can make the construction sustainable? Planning is one aspect. Are we planning for sustainability? So each and every project now, they're looking at sustainable parameters. You may do a planning for a smart city, planning for a road project, metro project. Everything comes with perfect planning. So we need to have sustainable planning also for each and every project. How much carbon footprint we are saving, and how much emissions we are controlling, how much natural resources we are reducing in a particular project. So in that aspect, the material science comes into picture and plays a very important role. So as a group company, we are not only into production of various products, we are into sports. JSW Sports, one of the leading sports company in India. And we are encouraging Olympic sports medals through Inspire Institute of Sports. And recently, the Olympics, Tokyo Olympics, we have sponsored the Olympics from Indian side. And many athletes were sponsored by JSW who have won medals. Similar way, we are into educational and training wherever our plants are there across India. Close to 20 locations, we are having plants, cement plants, steel plants, paint plants, and many other establishments. There, our focus is on children education, rural development. So as a group company, through JSW Foundation, we are doing all this work for the development of the society. During COVID lockdown, second COVID wave, we have established a 1,000 bed capacity hospital with a continuous oxygen supply near our Bellary factory in Karnataka. The oxygen was supplied in a pipeline. So because people were suffering because of oxygen shortage. So whatever the oxygen we were producing, we converted into medical oxygen. And through a pipeline, to all the beds, 1,000 beds, the oxygen was being supplied. That is the commitment of JSW Group. And it's a journey of JSW Cement. We are growing year on year. And the future is to have a 25 million ton capacity cement production in the country. That too, making the cement production the least carbon footprint. We are not cutting down the emissions of carbon below 300 kg per ton of cement production through various means of sustainable cement production, sustainable materials, sustainable manufacturing. This is our current area we are catering now. We are very strong in south, west, and also in the eastern part. And next year, we are going to start a cement plant in Rajasthan. With that, we'll become a pan-India player. These are our various products of JSW Group, all eco-friendly products. PSC cement, where it can replace more than 55% of slag. Comsem, it's a blend of GGBS and fly ash. Fly ash from the thermal power plants. We take our own thermal power plants are running. So we are using all these industrial byproducts to make eco-friendly products. GGBS is one product which goes into ready-mix plants. India is having more than 6,000 ready-mix plants. Our concrete production is close to about 60 to 70 million cubic meter per month all over India. So we are contributing a lot for the reduction of CO2 emissions through supplying GGBS to the RMC plant. One more product, natural river sand. We all be knowing the dredging of the river basin is stopped for the extraction of the river sand. JSW, looking into the future, we have developed our own sand, manufactured sand. As per IS 383-2016, the sand qualifies for applications in concrete and plastering applications. These are our products. So I'll come to the main topic of the today presentation, the background for planning. So urban planning, why urban planning is so important. So dear friends, my students, all the cities now look at Madurai. I visited almost, I must have visited more than 40 to 50 cities because through various assignments in my companies, not only here, Reliance, then Prism Johnson, RMC India, then JSW. I've traveled length and breadth of the country. A few states I may not have visited. So I've seen cities, how the congestion is there. Because in India, we never planned our cities. Only a few cities have been planned in India. One city is the Chandigarh city, which is planned perfectly. All the cities cities were there, we kept on expanding. The population started growing after the 1991 economic liberalization. So cities started growing because IT came. I'm seeing the growth of Bangalore. I'm in Bangalore from 1986. So I know, the population was 15 lakh population at that time. Now it is close to 1.2 crores. Like that, Chennai is there, Madurai, Coimbatore. I visited many cities in Tamil Nadu, Salem for market survey during my tenure in the RMC. I used to visit many cities for market survey. So I've traveled length and breadth of many cities like Madurai, Salem, Chennai, then Tuticorin, Trichy to establish RMC plants. So I could see the cities in Tamil Nadu are very, very big. Almost each and every district is a big city. So what is happening? Have we planned it properly? Because there is a continuous migration of the population to the cities in search of employment, search of good healthcare, better medical facilities. So continuously the people from the rural area are migrating to the cities. So are the cities are sustainable? That is the biggest challenge. So it calls for planning. Okay, already there were old plans. So every 3 to 4 years, every city will say it's a master plan for 2025, master plan for 2030. They make a plan and leave it there only. Okay. So next time they will modify and say this is a new plan. They keep on adding more areas. Have they developed cities on the planning what they have done? Not at all. Because we need to have a proper planning. A person living in one corner of the city, having a housing, will travel 30 kilometers to attend his factory, to attend his job. So that is what our misplanning. We don't provide employment opportunity where the job the housing is there. So people in search of job, they're shifting cities, shifting country. Continuously, it's evolving. So planning is very important, especially urban planning. Looking at the nature of how the cities are growing in India, there's an exponential growth. 30 to 40% growth of the cities is happening continuously because of continuous migration of the people from the rural areas, and also migration from one city to another city search of employment. I keep seeing people working in Chennai who are based out of Bangalore. And people are working in Bangalore, they are based out of Chennai. They are continuously traveling from one place to another place. So urban planning requires proper layout planning, proper transportation system, infrastructure facilities, zoning of the areas, residential, commercial, factory, industrial zones. So these are very important things. If you don't do a proper zoning, then the cities will develop in an opposite way and create huge problem for managing. Even the traffic police also, we are recruiting every year. That is not sufficient. The traffic management is a big issue. And in the urban area, the travel time is 3 to 4 kilometers per hour. City like Bangalore in the peak hour can only travel 3 kilometers per hour. That is the problem we are facing. So as per the United Nations report, global scenario, they talk about 4.2 billion people are living in cities out of about 7 billion population. So they say it is going to continuously grow, and we are going to have only mega and tetra cities. Mega is a small word to describe, mega and giga. So now the world terminology is mega and giga. So huge population growth is happening because we are seeing the cities, Bangalore or Chennai or Madurai Coimbatore. I am continuously seeing the cities expanding continuously. More and more layouts are coming. Okay, urban planning is happening. But how we are efficiently planning, how we are efficiently creating an infrastructure in a sustainable manner, that is very important. We are talking about smart cities. I'll come to that later on. How efficiently last 5 to 6 years of smart cities development plans are happening. How we are progressing? Where is nail pace? Everybody must have submitted their plan of smart city development, but it's not happening properly. So need for change. So our rapidly growing urban world is experiencing huge congestion, lack of basic infrastructure, then shortage of adequate housing, declining infrastructure. More than 30% of the world's population lives in slum. There you take Bangalore or Chennai or any other place. Slums are predominantly there, especially Bombay, Calcutta, mega cities. We have huge slum population. It is a global phenomenon, not only in India. Everywhere slums are there. So how we can develop cities, how we can integrate everything, that is very important for all the planners. When you want to do a proper planning, when you graduate after doing M.Tech, you may join a department, the town planning department. They were talking about by 2030, there's one statement, I could not put it here, 3 lakh town planners are required in India. Each and every city requires a town planner. They have currently only 6,000 town planners are there. So 3 lakh town planners are required. So town planning is going to play a very important role. Even though we are structural engineers, the town planning is going to play a very important role. You get good opportunity as a town planner. So India and urbanization potentials, talking about how the population is growing in India. They're talking about India projected to add 416 million urban dwellers between 2018 to 2050. Okay, so that is going to be the population growth. The shift people, the titanic shift from the rural population to the urban population is going to happen, expected to grow. The statistics itself shows that unless we do proper planning, it is not going to sustain. Even though government has put a lot of missions, Jawaharlal Nehru National Urban Renewal Mission, these programs have been started long back. Atal Mission, Smart City Project, Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana for housing for all project. So many projects have started. Government is doing it, but at the end of the day, it's a responsibility of the citizens, the engineers, the planning engineers, to really develop sustainable cities through a proper urban planning. So why urban planning is important in today's context? Dear friends, you know, when the huge population start migrating to the urban cities, we have a cluster development. Okay, like in, especially I'm giving for an example of Karnataka. Karnataka population is 6 crores. Out of that, 1.2 crores in only Bangalore, 1,000 square kilometer. The geographical boundary of Karnataka is 1.76 lakhs square kilometers. So almost one-fifth of the population is living in 1,000 square kilometers. See, that is the density. Similar way, I can give many examples for Chennai, Tamil Nadu cities. So more and more people start living in cities. So what will happen? Cities get congested. We cannot provide proper transportation facility, infrastructure facility, water, sewage treatment, good medical facility. It becomes a burden on any cities. So in this context, we need to plan new cities. Why we need to only develop Bangalore? So the government has to look into that direction. Why we have to only develop Chennai or Madurai? Why can't we build a new cities? This direction, India also has built two, three new cities in Gujarat. Gift City is one example. Like that, many countries all over the world, they are building new cities with a new infrastructure completely, so that they can, in the starting phase only, during the planning stage only, they can put a proper plan, proper systems. Now we are doing smart city. Bangalore also, example, I am seeing in front of my own office, they're doing smart city project. Almost 1 year it has taken. Now they are not able to lay a proper one road because they have to shift all the utilities which has been there for two centuries to one single line and shift it and properly place it and also make the road. It's taking 1 year. So any development you want to do on an existing infrastructure is very difficult. So I'm showing some pictures. Like this is a Bangalore photo. See the gridlocked traffic, two-wheeler, cars, then urban slums. This is the slums development happening. Then garbage. Look at the life of children there who are living adjacent to the slums and garbage area. So what has happened? Because of all that congestion and there is no proper drainage of rainwater, because we are concreting each and every inch of urban space. We are building house, we are making tar roads, we are making footpath, everywhere we are putting concrete. So we are avoiding the percolation of rainwater to the ground. So what will happen? There will be complete, whatever the rainfall happens, surface runoff. The moment if it drains very heavily, we have seen the floods in Chennai, floods in Bangalore, floods in Mumbai, many cities. Recently, we saw a huge flood in China because of the changes in the atmospheric temperatures and heavy rainfall happening, concentrated rainfall happening at a single place. These are the various scenario we are seeing. So how, what's happening? Like we can see every year it become common phenomena. Earlier it used to happen one time, now at least 3 to 4 times a year, it's a continuous. We are not able to escape from that, because our plans are such like that there is no free flow of surface water to the storm water drain or Raja Kalwe or to the river basin. Not happening, because we have built along the river beds, we have built our infrastructure along the flow of water. That's the reason. So how, like how animals are coming to the urban environment from the forest, because we went and occupied forest. So they had no place to survive there. They came to the urban environment. So we are continuously seeing many elephants or cheetah entering into houses. In Bangalore city, outskirts and all, we are seeing that happening. So friends, I have shown that photograph. So better planning is very important. Better urban planning is very important. If you do the proper planning using technology, we can really create a well-placed development. So it requires for well-educated architects, civil engineers, city administration, everybody should come together. So Bangalore, they started making some roads, the city central. It becomes a model in 60 countries. Smart city project and many roads. They the roads were shrunk, they made more footpath wherever the metro lines are there. So that what made that people should walk to their work from the metro station. That was the concept. So it became successful, and many 60 countries, they came and witnessed, they wanted to adopt this technology. So like that, if you make a benchmark decision where people will come and follow and take it forward. The same model was replicated in many cities, having a better footpath, making people to walk on the road. So it will also improve your life expectancy, because we work in the office in the computer environment and get strained in the AC environment. If you go out and start walking to your metro station or any other station, your mode of transportation, it will also improve your health. These are the things. As I told you earlier, the 1990 saw the economic liberalization announced by the central government. After that, all the cities are growing leaps and bounds. The huge investment is also coming. I'm seeing huge investment. So people are building tall structures. They're building metros. They're building IT parks. They're building manufacturing facilities, housing. But the investment on the urban infrastructure is very less. How we can make the urban infrastructure livable? That is very important for all of us. So it requires for creating education, job creation, innovation, art and culture. So as per the one statistics say, how the urban population is growing from 1961 to 2011, as per the last census, they have done the growth of urban population starting from 78.94 million to 377 million, that is 37 crores population. So by this time, the population may be about 45 crores urban environment, and also growth. They have shown 31% growth. This is a 10-year plan they have shown. Next will be 2022. They will show you the results. So looking at the population growth, the government of India also, they have taken planning. 2012 to 17 plan, I had some details and all. I did not get the latest plan updates. So what they have decided is that they want to go with rapid mass transportation systems like metro. Wherever the city is having more than 15 lakhs population, they started metros. Earlier, metro was only there in Delhi, Calcutta. Now, many cities are having. Chennai is having, Bangalore having, Cochin having, Nagpur, Pune, Hyderabad. Many cities now they are having metros now. Jaipur metro, Delhi metro, Lucknow metro. I can say that is the one of the best mode of transportation for the urban dwellers. Metro has come to my house, also near my house. I can come in half an hour, comfortably sitting in a metro, 13 kilometers. I can reach my office within 45 minutes or 50 minutes. If I use my own car, it will take 1.5 hours. Sometimes it takes 2 hours. Somewhere it is. So the mass rapid system is changing the way we are going to live. Then creating very good water bodies, treating the water for water, efficient use of urban land, go for high-rise buildings. Wherever the metro lines are there, should allow the development to happen, because most people would live across the metro line. So that commuting becomes easy from home to work or home to shopping, commercial ops and all. So metro line, like that way is integrating and connecting the urban space. So talking about environmental sustainability is very important. So cities are the biggest creator of jobs, opportunity. Like that way, they are the biggest creator of waste, slums, carbon dioxide emissions. In Bangalore, only 1.5 crores vehicles are there. So imagine, so all the vehicles come on road and start emitting carbon dioxide. Construction happens maximum in cities. So construction alone emit 10% of the dust, and total CO2 emissions happening from construction, from cradle to grave, is about 30%. With all that, there's a need to develop a proper scheme for urban development. So looking at a perfect planned city, India also building many cities now, along with China, other Asian countries. So we need to build a proper system where we can maintain the city. This is a small city, maybe 30 acres, 40 acres. Cities are being built with the proper planning, where they stay at one place, they go to work here, they may go for sports here. Like that, I have seen Singapore. I have visited many countries, more than 16 countries, sir. So I could see a Singapore university where it is in the center of the city. In India, we are having 1,000 acres, 500 acres. I have seen Bharatiyar University was 700 acres. Or Bangalore University, where I studied, 1,000 acres. So there in Singapore, university is in the right in the heart of city. 1,000 acres is unimaginable. So they have created all the facilities. They have swimming, they have sports, they have training center, everything in the building only, vertically only they have developed. One floor, maybe car parking, one floor more, volleyball, football. Only I think they are not able to do football stadium they have not built. But other small sports facility they have built on the terraces in various floors and all. That's how it will work. So, as I told you, the population growth by 2050 will be phenomenal, and we need to take care of that. We, being young engineers, we should all take up urban planning. Many good opportunities are available. As I told you, 3 lakh jobs are available in the planning department only. So unless you do proper planning, whatever the construction happens is not going to be sustainable. So you should plan for sustainable planning. Sustainable planning requires utilization of the natural resources, locally available materials, building a sustainable infrastructure, reducing the carbon footprint, reducing the dust, reducing the pollution. These are all very important things. So issue with the existing model of city development are many. Unplanned expansion of the cities. Then if the cities are developing, you go for satellites. So these are not really helped in India so far. But I can say to make cities more sustainable, we are looking at sustainable development goals as per the Paris Accord. The Paris Agreement happened in 2015. So they are looking at how to make the cities and more sustainable by adopting green technologies. Okay, reducing the fresh water, reduction in the wastage. Many things they have discussed. So by 2030, plan for India. So now we are currently 2021. So another 9 years is there. This is what the plan by India the target plans for India, how to make the cities sustainable. That is the mantra of the government. So what they are talking about, they have got many goals. I'll share this presentation to all of you. So they are looking at providing affordable housing, accessible and sustainable transportation systems like metro, improving road safety, accidents. India, it's the only country where your road accidents are many. So because we don't have a proper road safety systems. Notably, expanding the public transportation systems with special attentions to the vulnerable situations like women and children, persons with disability, how we are taking care of them. Singapore, 3-4 times I have gone, the people, disabled people, you go to any metro station, go to any bus station, any mall, there's a separate passage where a disabled person also with a wheelchair can go and do shopping. They put a proper ramp. Any public building, ramp is a must. So are we having such kind of facility in India? Really, I find. Maybe now they are adopting, but so they make the cities livable for everybody. That is what's the plan. We should have that plan properly. So these are various plans, various systems that the Indian government is adopting to make it more easy. So that is the second part of my presentation is over. So the planning should be perfect, dear friends. We all know, being civil engineers, we don't plan properly, we are going to have problems. There may be your job, there will be marriage, taking care of your parents, saving. Everything has to be properly planned. So then only we can have a successful life. Similar way, to have a very smart city. Smart city, what do we call smart city? Why we call it smart city? So smart city evolve on its own, actually. Okay. The term is very good, smart city, we keep on telling. So nobody has understood what is a smart city. Should have a proper basic infrastructure. Use smart solutions, technology, artificial intelligence, machine learning, then the blockchain. So there are so many technologies. You may not be able to see all these things, but these technologies are enabling. Okay. So now cities like Singapore, Kuala Lumpur and all, we don't see people, police on the road, stopping the vehicles, collecting a fine for traffic offense, anything at all. Hardly you find any police on the roads of Singapore, Malaysia, Europe, Japan, any country. I was wondering, in India, all police we see standing on the road, stopping the vehicle and collecting money. Why it is so? Because we don't have systems. Go to Dubai, you don't find people. I happened to travel in Dubai with one of my friend and all. He was taking to me one place and it was going very slow. There was a speed limit written, 40 kilometers per hour. Just following the open road, nobody is there. In India, would have such a, we had a very good car. We had a Benz car. So I said, hey, go fast, why you are going slow? He said, last time, I mistook the government. I rode on the road at a much higher speed. He told me the fine was 5,000 dirhams, 5,000 into 20, 1 lakh rupees. That he said, that was my saving, I completely lost. If I commit once again offense, next place will be jail. Said, I don't have money to pay the fine. That is the fine they put. So the violations, sir. Here somehow we circumvent. We have to develop such a kind of a system where automatically it gets fined. The cameras are on the road side everywhere. So cameras are watching you. I don't think India is not capable of doing that. Very soon it may happen. Some roads they are putting on the expressway, the camera. Automatically it's getting captured. I'm coming from somewhere where there was a camera. Was coming from on expressway. So the driver was telling me, sir, that they have kept a camera behind, they are catching the numbers. If I'm driving fast, automatically I'll get a challan. That's what the thing they were telling. So these are the various things. So objective of a smart city, dear friends, it is improving quality of life. Okay. why you are all going abroad? You going to America, in Singapore, Dubai for job and opportunity. So there you go. After going there, you will not come back. So many Indians have settled down. Why? The reason behind? So those cities are offering better life. Systems are very good. You don't get tired and all. So the cities are very clean. There is no dust, dirt. Same people who are living in India, who have gone there, they are following all the traffic rules, all the rules of that steel city, because their fine is more. If you do more offense, you will be jailed. In India, you can always escape. You find some other way of escaping. That's the reason that we always try to break the law instead of following the law. That is the major problem. You may put the best of the system in place, smart city, smart roads. The people who are living in that city, they don't follow, you're going to have a major problem. So the basic infrastructure has to be there. The water supply, the roads, the sanitation, affordable housing, robust IT connectivity. So you should get the phone, Wi-Fi. Wherever you are going, some cities, I have some smart cities, Putrajaya I have seen in Malaysia, I have gone there. So their internet is free. Anywhere you can get connected with the internet. Free Wi-Fi. Okay, you don't really have to have a net facility. So generally when I go abroad, I don't take a net pack from this thing. I'll go and buy a small SIM there, maybe paying some 1,500 rupees in that range. So internet is available everywhere. I don't really have to buy any currency. That is the robustness of the cities. Health and education systems, safety norms are very important for the women. So I was giving one example, Singapore, I was there. Around 1 o'clock, we had gone on a trip and all, we were roaming on the street. So I could see the women's, Japan also I have seen, Tokyo, the women walking on the road, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock night, without any fear at all. Can they do it in India, any city, Bangalore or Delhi or Chennai? Next day we see some gang rape in the newspaper. So that's what, they're also human being, we're also human being. Okay, that kind of a robust safety norms are there. Unless we provide a good life to all the citizens in a city, we are not going to achieve much success. So economic activity should be there, livelihood should be protected. Somebody loses job, we should get a proper food and support from the government. Are we doing that? Not at all. So smart city solutions are there. Urban mobility is very important. Energy management is very important. How we can meter it. In India now they are putting the underground electric cable. So if you go to any cities like Patna and all, I've seen electric wire, thousands of line crisscrossing, and I'll say cobweb type. I've seen Guwahati. Okay, in the Chennai also I have seen, you see the electrical pole, all things run along the electrical pole only. Your cable, your dish TV connections, everything. So we create a cobweb system. Okay. And waste management, horrible. When those are waste collection departments are there, we keep throwing. I am seeing an IT guy, sir. So while going to the office, sir, they bring the garbage from their home. Okay. Husband and wife, I have seen husband and wife going on a motorcycle. Okay, slowly they take the garbage bag and they just throw it on the road. One person will throw on, I have seen on my own road, it will be clean. So one person will just throw one packet. Okay, that becomes a spot for throwing garbage. Next 5 days, I can see heaps of garbage kept on there. Feel that is the place we can throw garbage. They keep on dumping. That is our mentality. It's our mentality. So the city solutions, smart city solutions, look for proper energy management, waste to composite, treating wastewater, treating grey water, recycling and reduction in the CND waste. These are the various hallmarks of city. Smart parking, automatic parking, intelligent traffic management system, like continuous traffic flow. These are all hallmarks of smart solutions using Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, machine learning. These are all technologies. I have also went through some software course recently on data science and all. How we can really design systems, integrate everything together, manage everything. A single camera will show what is happening in the entire city, sitting at one place. You don't have to go everywhere. So you have to have that system in place so that we'll manage our system properly. So that's what I'm telling, smart metering, smart water metering. So people don't have to come and open your water meter and put a bill. Automatically, you should get that measurement. Controlling crime, cyber crime, real-time online system, on monitoring of water supply, water quality on time. I visited BWS, Bangalore Water Supply Board. I could met an engineer, executive engineer. He was telling me how smart he was. He used to had a dashboard and he was used to point at this place. There's a blockade. This place is what smart metering. Smart metering. Each and every flow, every pipeline, they have done the sensors and all. They're able to find out what's happening, whether it's flowing or not, where is the blockade. Immediately they alert the system and rectify. I saw that one of the best example in India they have done for water supply scheme in Bangalore urban water supply scheme. Similar way, making the roads walkable, cycling path. So we need to create an integrated infrastructure for making everybody to enjoy the facility. So area-based development models. So retrofitting. Redevelopment, greenfield projects. These are the various models they have adopted for smart cities in India, where retrofitting is nothing but redeveloping the existing area. Existing built up area greater than 500 acres so as to achieve the objective of smart city mission to make it more efficient and livable. Ahmedabad local area development they have done. Then greenfield projects, GIFT City, and Raipur also they have developed as a new greenfield city. Like that way, India is also trying to build many new cities. Redevelopment. Redevelopment, a Bendi Bazaar in Mumbai, one of the projects taken by Smart City Mission. These are the slides from Smart City Mission data, which announced by the Government of India. So components of area-based development. Holistic development of existing and new areas properly. Whatever the existing is there, build it to the world-class level. Whatever the new cities, have a proper planning. Like that, we need to look at housing, especially poor, making workable, livable cities, public space, public transport, parks. All these are all very important. And how the government, the citizens, and the agencies can work together to achieve success in a most cost-effective manner. This is the first city in India, Chandigarh. It's well planned. I visited Chandigarh city. Amazing city. Amazing city. Roads are very wide. I thought I entered some foreign country when I visited Chandigarh. Two, three times I visited. One should go and see the urban planning in Chandigarh, how they have done. Well planned city. Fantastic city. All you are structural engineers, I think if time permits, you take a tour of Chandigarh, which is there inside India only, where you can see the perfect planning. Well-planned cities make the living very simple and very easy. This is Raipur, a new city which is being built. So there, their proper planning is there. Some of the cities in India also, Baroda or Mysore city. So these cities are well-planned. Congestion is not there. So like that, as the population is increasing, globally, each and every country is planning some new cities, cities within the city. I have visited some of the cities like Putrajaya, Malaysia. This city I visited, they have developed a complete new system, housing, government buildings, everything. It's a new city. Proper planning is there. Like that, in, many townships are coming in Bangalore also, like Prestige City, Prestige Jindal City. Some 40, 50 acres, 150 acres land they take and develop. So where they have proper planning, housing, then we have entertainment, malls, then World Trade Center, then hospitals, schools. Within the same setup, everything is there. People don't have to travel outside. Only if they want to visit somebody, the relatives or anybody, they should go out. Most of the time, they can live within that city only. So otherwise, what is happening now? We are jumping from one place to another place for some sort of job, in terms of meeting the customers. This lockdown, COVID has really taught us a lesson. Earlier, for everything, we used to go and physically meet everybody. Now, most of our jobs are happening. Kartiyani madam was telling me everything we are doing online. I don't know how students are learning. They should only tell me. So many students, they switch on and they won't listen. Now also it may be happening. I don't really know how many people are interested, how many people are getting bored actually. I don't really know. So we can't really monitor, okay? So we cannot police everybody. It's their interest to learn everything. Very important. So like that, I'm showing globally the next 10 years, which are the cities which are planned and coming one by one. This is taken from various websites and all. See, King Abdullah Economic City Corridor, Saudi Arabia. Huge investment, some $20 billion investment they are making. They're all rich countries, they can plan and develop. Okay, India cannot adopt same technology. This is one new area, China, industrial town. They are having factories, they're having housing, schools, everything. They take land and develop everything together. Kazakhstan, this is a new city they are developing. China, forest city. Look at the city, how green it is. Although it's vertical, they have grown forest over the houses. It's China. China, because the population is huge. India, we are overtaking that kind of a population, but we are not developing cities like that. Till we are only want to develop Chennai, Bangalore, add more extensions. We're not developing any new cities in an aggressive manner. South Korea, Saudi Arabia, Malaysia, Cairo, new city development. So the Sustainable Goal, World Green Building Council, one of the leading green building council, sustainability in construction using eco-friendly materials. Okay, talking about. So how we can design buildings? You are all civil engineers. At the end of the day, we are out to look into how we can make the construction sustainable and green building. There are many sustainable goals are there. So why we have to have green buildings? Green building can improve the health and well-being of the people. Green building can use renewable energy, become cheaper. Green building infrastructure create jobs and boost economy. That's one thing. Green building design can spur innovation and contribute to climate resilient infrastructure. Green building are the fabric of sustainable communities and cities. Green building use circular economy principles, so resources are optimized. Green building produce fewer emissions. That's what I'm going to talk about in the next presentations, helping to combat climate change. Green buildings can improve biodiversity, save water, resources, help to protect forest. Through building green, we create strong global partnership. This is the Sustainable Development Goals as per the World Green Building Council. My dear students, I'm coming to the core topic, concrete. I already told you concrete is the second most consumed product on this planet after water. What water we drink, second most consumed. So, you know, production of cement. Cement, without cement, we cannot make concrete. Without geopolymer, concrete has come. But it cannot do that much, only maybe 0.1%. So when we want to make cement, we consume 1.5 tons of limestone. We emit 0.8 to 1 ton carbon dioxide. Clinker manufacturing, I'm talking about. So coal consumption also is not an eco-friendly activity. Electricity, to generate electricity, use thermal. So with all that, the hazards associated with Portland cement are many. Carbon emissions, water pollution, release of heavy metals to the atmosphere. And globally, we are contributing 5 to 6% of carbon dioxide by cement alone. Okay, not good. So sustainability needs are the impacts of construction. When we want to do construction, we're only looking at building construction. So we are excavating the earth, building construction. We need energy to maintain the buildings, heating and cooling, and we create a lot of dust. These are the statistics available. 30% of the global greenhouse emissions are happening from construction. 10% of the world's emission, fine dust, the dust we inhale. Okay. Anyway, now everybody is wearing mask and all. So somehow we are avoiding this thing. They were telling when the there was first lockdown, people could see Himalaya from Delhi. Delhi, the most polluted city in the world. You have to wear oxygen masks during winter season where there is no flow of air. So that city, from that city, they could see Himalaya range. Imagine, the Himalayan range may be about 40, 50, some 500,000 kilometers away from the Delhi. That is controlling the pollution, because pollution got controlled. Vehicles were not there on the road. There was no economic activity. There was no pollution from the factories. Okay, so sustainable requirements require sustainable solutions. So the greenhouse gas emission, which is harming the environment. Because of that, the ocean temperatures are rising. Between Atlantic, Indian Ocean and Pacific Ocean, there's a temperature gradient of 1 degree. That 1 degree gradient itself is making the water to evaporate from the Indian Ocean. We are seeing unseasonal cyclones. Chennai is best example. Chennai is always hit by some cyclones and other things. So we are getting floods, because heavy rainfall will, concentrated rainfall will happen at one place within a very short duration. So the runoff is more. As I already told you, all the urban areas are concreted. So we are getting floods. All the cities are becoming oceans. I don't know, after 20 years, even cities like Chennai or Bangalore may submerge inside water. Heavy rains happen. That's going to be there. The urban heat island effect, because the buildings are coming in the urban space, there is no free flow of air from one direction to another direction. There is no free flow, the temperature will go up automatically. It's called urban heat island effect. So the urban temperature will rise 2 to 3 degrees centigrade compared to the surrounding area where agriculture vegetation is there. That's what the problem. So I already told you, 7% emissions from steel, 5% emissions from cement, 12% emissions, these two products only. Overall, it's about 30%. So, but being civil engineers, as I've already told you, population is increasing. We cannot stop construction. We are going for high-rise buildings one after the other, Chennai, Bangalore and all, 50-story, 60-story, 100-story buildings. They're also coming in India. Mumbai is the best example. There, they have gone up to 165 floors. So we're also building tall structures. So when we want to build tall structures, and the cement is the main building material, how we can control the optimize the usage of natural materials, maybe river sand, maybe cement, how we can reduce the usage of pure cement by replacing it. So we have to look for alternative materials. Science and technology in India is developing very fast. Civil engineering field also, we have a lot of innovation happening. So we are all civil engineers. We are all graduating as M.Tech structural graduates. So you have great responsibility. Okay. After getting a degree, you always look for a better job and marriage and settling down. We are all looking for all that. But you also look up how to make the city sustainable. Whatever job you are doing, maybe a contracting, maybe planning department, or you may be a town planner, any other field you take, structural engineer, you have to adopt technology, make the construction sustainable and durable. That is our duty. So common sense of sustainability is nothing that you have to optimize the usage of materials. Okay. The combination effect is that we need to develop meeting the current present demand without compromising the needs of the future generation. Friends, I would like to clarify here. So we cannot stop construction. We need to continuously build roads, build metros, build infrastructure. Because talking about $800 billion or $1 trillion investment happening in the construction alone. So we cannot stop construction. Otherwise, we will not get jobs, any of you. We need to get jobs means you need construction is very much required. Well, constructing how to make the construction sustainable, I'm going to talk about that. A practice of creating structures and using processes that are environmentally responsible and resource efficient throughout the building's life cycle, from site to design, what we call as cradle to grave, construction, operation, maintenance, renovation, and demolition. Everything should be properly maintained. So sustainable cycle says that we need to have social viable, should be equitable, financially should be bearable, and finally achieving environmental impact, economic profit, social people benefit the society. These are all the sustainability cycle. So general consensus is that CO2 emissions should be reduced, energy consumption should be reduced, prolonged life for the buildings, for the citizens who live, prolonged life for both buildings and people, because if you provide proper environment, carbon dioxide free air, good oxygen concentration, your life expectancy also will go. These are all hallmark of sustainability cycle. Using global solutions, bringing world-class technology for local solutions, IT, Internet of Things, machine learning, carbon chain, all this, these are all technological terms. We have to use them to make the construction sustainable and durable. That's very important. So coming to my core subject, concrete, my subject of importance, concrete. When we make concrete, we use many natural materials. We use aggregates, we use river sand, we use water. Water is so much scarcity is there. We use water continuously, because we need to have good quality water for making concrete also. Whatever water we drink, we should use for concrete making. So I was in the site engineer. My first job was a site engineer. So I went to the project manager, and I was a very small young boy. So there was no water actually. Okay. There was a small pond near to the site, and all. There was no supply of water, and I wanted to use that water. So I went and asked the project manager. He was Dubai returned. I worked in Dubai. And I went, sir, I want to use this water for construction and touring. So he said, no, don't do, Manjunath. Okay, first, you bring the glass of water to drink. If you come to the site tomorrow without any fever or any this thing, then I'll allow you to use that water. So what he was indicating me was that the water, what you use for concrete making also, should be a portable water. You cannot use any other water. Water having acids, chemicals, alkalis, you cannot use sewage water. You should have a good water. Cities like Chennai, you face a lot of water shortage. So how to make the concrete sustainable? Very important. So a lot of evolution has happened in the concrete technology. You're getting many types of concrete. You must be all learned about high performance concretes, high performance concrete, geopolymer concrete, fiber reinforced concrete, self-compacting, high early strength, low density, high density. There are so many types of concrete. More than 50 types of concrete are available. Reactive powder concrete, then color concrete. So these are all been designed using various technology, make the concrete sustainable. High volume fly ash concrete, high volume GGBS concrete, where GGBS can go up to 70% to 80% replacement of OPC cement. That's how you can make it. So sustainable concrete means you have to optimize the minerals, materials, what you are going to use for concreting. Recycling and waste management, very important. If you do a demolition building, recycling of the C&D waste, construction and demolition waste is very important. Using innovation, using very good admixtures, which can reduce the water demand up to 40%. Today, we are able to make concrete with a water cement ratio of 0.25 to 0.3. Earlier, we were using 0.5, 0.6. Your water demand per cubic meter has come down to 125-130 liters. It was 186 liters. There only you can save, because millions of cubic meter concrete you are making, and using self-curing concrete, so where you don't require to cure the concrete, or using the curing compounds. So many people are using, because water is not available for curing nowadays for mega projects. They want to adopt technology. So already I've discussed about these points. Cement can replace the GGBS, can replace the fly ash, ultrafine materials are available. The cement can be replaced up to almost 70% to 80% by using mineral admixtures. Aggregates, so fresh aggregates, we can use recycled aggregates. We can use aggregates from steel industry, aggregates from fly ash industry, aggregates from copper slag. All this we can replace them. So saving the virgin material and using, we can use 30%, 40%, no problem. That much you are cutting down. Imagine the whole city of Chennai start using 30% recycled aggregates for construction. How the things will change? To change dramatically. Water is very important. So recharging the groundwater, recycling the water is very important. Adopting all this technology, we need to go for improved durability concrete. We cannot sacrifice the quality of the concrete. Durability is very important. That's the hallmark of construction and quality. Go to the next topic. So what we expect from concrete? Expect many things from concrete. We want to be properly workable, pumpable, transportable. Shouldn't have any cracks. It should attain compressive strength. 3 days, 7 days, 28 days, 56 days, 90 days compressive strength. Should have proper structural strength in terms of pavement quality concrete. Should have durability. Low shrinkage, low creep. In a mass concreting application, shrinkage plays a very important role. Low creep, water impermeability, alkali silica reaction, sulfate resistance, chloride resistance. These are the various things we are looking for the concrete. Our IS code also is permitting the usage of mineral admixtures, both fly ash and GGBS. We can use this product to make concrete in various percentages. Fly ash, we can go with 35% maximum. GGBS, as per the codal, up to 70% we can go. Because the GGBS is having both calcium oxide as well as silicon dioxide. So it more towards cement, Portland cement. Fly ash is more towards silica. Okay. So we have to have the combination of products based on availability, pricing parameters. You can use fly ash. Chennai predominantly use fly ash. Slag they are using now. Because fly ash is available, it's very economical and cheap. Like that they are having. So, using cementitious material like fly ash or GGBS, what are the benefits we are going to get? These are all hundreds of years of research work. I can proudly say it will reduce the heat of hydration, shrinkage cracks, mass foundations, increase water tightness for water tanks, waterproofing effect, reduction in the alkali silica reaction if the aggregates are having alkalis. So that is very detrimental to concrete, especially mass concreting application like dams, irrigation projects. We need to avoid alkali aggregation reactions. Then improved resistance to sulfate attack and chloride attack, seawater. Chennai is a coastline. So along the coastline, we need to go minimum M30 grade concrete. People still are using M20, M25. You are all becoming the engineers of the future. For the coastal environment, never approve any M20, M25 grade concrete, except it's a lean concrete. The reinforced concrete should be start from M30 grade only. That should, we should take it at oath and do it. So with all that, you get lower cost. Because cementitious materials, they come from as a byproduct, so they are economical compared to pure OPC cement. Cheaper. The improvement in various parameters, it's written here. This is a well-researched article. Laterite strength go up by almost 40%. With of hydration, reduced by 35%. Reduced pore volume, that is particle packing effect, 60%. Water tightness, 34%. Chloride attack, sulfate attack, 60-90%. Alkali aggregate reaction, 86%. These are all unimaginable parameters. These are all coming by using a mineral admixture like GGBS. This can be replaced up to 70%. Easily you can achieve this success. So there's no limitations. You can make any types of concrete. I've already told you various types of concrete, so special concrete. So all these concretes can be made using the mineral admixtures, which brings more sustainability and durability in construction. And all the countries globally, they are using Ireland 100% blended cement, Luxembourg, Italy 93, Finland, Slovakia 89, Spain. Look at the percentage of the blended cements, blended concrete they are using, they are adopting. Why can't we use the same thing in India also? Because products are available. Fly ash is available, GGBS is also available everywhere. These are the various products of JSW Group. Already I told you. Once talking about the blast furnace slag, may not be aware how it is being manufactured. It comes from a blast furnace. This is a blast furnace in the steel manufacturing. We add coke, iron ore, and limestone together and make a raw mix. A well-blended raw mix come to blast furnace to make steel. So what is going to happen is that the molten iron, which is heavier, it is taken out to make steel, various forms of steel, coils, TMT bars, etc. The molten slag, which is floating, which is about 30%, is taken out and quenched into fine granules. That's what we grind the slag into fine powder using cement mill. It's a non-metallic product, beautiful product. Globally, it is accepted everywhere. This is the way it is being done. So comparatively, GGBS is superior than the fly ash because it's having 40% calcium oxide, whereas less than 2% calcium oxide there in the fly ash. So silica also is very good, it's having silica 35%. So both hydraulic and pozzolanic. The moment the cement reacts with the water, so it will liberate calcium hydroxide gel and CSH, calcium hydroxide, which is a weak compound, CSH gel, it will liberate. So this GGBS will react with the CSH gel, calcium hydroxide, to evolve new products. Additional calcium silicate hydrate gel formation will happen. So it will hydrate up to 95% without any problem. So that's what we have done. JSW being a pioneer, sustainability is our in the heart of JSW business. So we have done a small comparison between 2015 to 2020, how the GGBS volumes in the RMC plants have increased. Close to 3 million tons per year we are supplying. So we could do 62.85 million cubic meter of concrete in 5 years' time. Like that way, so what has happened? We have replaced 6 million tons of cement, replaced by OPC, 6 million tons. Carbon dioxide reaction, 5.24 million tons. That is equivalent to planting 5.24 million trees, because one tree consumes 1 ton of carbon dioxide in its lifetime. That it's living for 60 years, 70 years, 1 ton. So taking that into consideration, to absorb carbon, 1 ton per one tree. Imagine if you have saved emissions by 5.24 million metric tons, it's equivalent to 5.24 million trees. Imagine you creating a new forest just by using the product. Physically, you may not see, but the effect of CO2 reduction is phenomenal. Limestone also conserving to the future generations, because you construct, what about your grandchildren? You want to construct, cement become 2,000 bag. What will you do? If you conserve the natural resource like limestone, you can substantiate for the next generation. Save it for the next generation. So similar way, so I'm giving a neck-to-neck comparison. 40% replacement up to OPC cement. And then,
your voice is breaking.
You too, most. You can save up to 105 kg of oxygen in carbon dioxide. Now it's okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now it's okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So like, that I've just done a calculation. So concrete 50 trees, 21,000 trees. These are the advantages of using GGBS. So many government specifications are there for GGBS, including metros. Chennai Metro is using our product. Chennai is using our product. Atomic energy, many road projects now, expressway. They are also likely to adopt GGBS for all their concrete applications. This is the PSC cement, which is well accepted in Chennai market and Tamil Nadu market. Many structural consultants are recommending this product. This is a slag based product. 55% slag we are using. So what are the advantages of cement? This is composite cement, highly high strength, highly durable, highly workable, resistance to chemical attack. These are the advantages of this product. So similar way, we have taken comparison between OPC cement and composite cement, which is a blend of slag and fly ash. All the durability parameters are addressed here. It's a green product. Similar way, river sand also. We are not using river sand in construction now. So slag sand is a byproduct of steel industry. First of its kind in the country. We are making slag sand from Bellary. These products are available for research work. If you want to do research, I'm ready to supply at Chennai also. We are making aggregates. The LD slags, we are making aggregates. The blast furnace, we are making sand and cement. As per the IS 38 specifications also, it's meeting the requirement. The zone 2 curve, you can see, available. With various percentage of the slag sand and the natural sand, we have done the comparative study. Everywhere it is giving very good results. There's no problem at all. Similar way, all our products are green certified, IGBC green certificate. If you use our JSW products, you can claim the points under IGBC. So that certification will be given by us for all our products. So at the end of the presentation, I would like to say that being young engineers, your duty to develop cities with the proper planning using sustainable materials. So I have clubbed everything together. You develop cities, the perfect planning using sustainable materials to achieve overall sustainability and growth for your career growth and also the growth of the country. So the other thing is that use technology, artificial intelligence, BIM, machine learning, proper project planning, softwares you use. Using all these things, you develop solutions for the next generations. With that, I would like to conclude my presentation. So achieving sustainability and durability is the necessity of the day. And whatever planning you do, for your construction, whether you're a planning engineer, town planner, a contracting company, whatever the job assignment you take, either you become a teacher, a professor in a college, we need to adopt sustainability. It's a way of life for all of us. Whatever we do, we have to conserve energy, conserve water, conserve natural resources. Each and every action, the need of the hour is achieving sustainability. With that, I would like to close my presentation. I thank Karthiyani Madam for providing this wonderful opportunity to share my presentation to all of you. Thank you one and all. It's over to Dr. Karthiyani Madam.
Thank you, thanks a lot, sir. Sir, it's a wonderful, very long and elaborate talking about sustainability and concrete, each and every part. It's really very useful to our students. Deeta, you're in mute.
Yes. It was a very informative session. As upcoming engineers with very less exposure to the real world as a professional, sir, your session was a treasure to be added to us. The presentation was just perfectly arranged, and I, as a representative of our class, would like to thank you, sir, for your valuable time. Let me once again thank Dr. Karthiyani ma'am and our dean, Dr. Muthumani sir, for your support. Without your enthusiasm, this session wouldn't have happened. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Any questions, students?
doubts.
System two charts are there.
Yes.
No questions means you not understood my lecture.
Students, Lokesh.
Ma'am, no question, ma'am. Actually, it was clear, ma'am.
You can share your feedback on the presentation. Anything you want to have.
Yes, sir. Already we are having that Google form. I had asked to fill that. Students, have you filled the Google form? The feedback?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Any questions?
Thank you, madam, for the opportunity. Yes, maybe I was a bit slow, I think. I don't know whether people could...
Just you, close your presentation, we will have a snapshot, sir.
Acha, okay, I'll do that. Yeah, that's a nice way of... So everybody on the this thing.
Correct? Please, if it is possible, when students, can you switch on your videos? Is it possible, means? Few of them. Thank you. We'll have a snapshot.
So thank you, madam.
Sir, thank you. Thank you so much for your valuable presentation and present. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, madam. It's my pleasure. It's my pleasure.
Thank you, sir. I will send a mail to you, sir. Thank you.
Yes, madam. Thank you.